It's so awesome to be back after 2 years with all of you guys here in one room. And I'm incredibly excited to be here with two investors, or three rock star women, to talk about femtech. Or do we actually talk about femtech? That's the whole point of the discussion. And we did have a bit of a discussion backstage, so I know this will be a funny, a really interesting debate. And I want to start with you, Therese. As a founder in the woman's female health space, you successfully raised money, you have been building the company for some time, and went through a lot from a marketing or company building perspective, communications point of view. I would love to hear your perspective on what do you feel when you hear the term femtech, and why do we actually have it given or coined the term?
Well, I think there are many questions in that question, but the first one is obviously when there is a norm, anything that falls out of the norm gets called something specific to manifest that it falls outside. And I think it's, to me, I don't have anything particular against it. I see the value of clearly communicating what it is that it's about, but it doesn't do anything for me or my company to be coined or termed femtech company. It's nothing that I usually call my own company, but it feels like it's a terminology that we become given from investor point of view to sort us into a category for portfolio companies rather than something else. But I also don't feel like there's a menacing aspect to it. I don't think it's a problem, but I just don't see the term itself doing anything particular to the problem of female entrepreneurs or women-related topics becoming funded, because that's the core. That's the core problem, is that concerns that might be prominent with the female audience, which is the majority in the world, it's not niche, gets termed something that falls outside of the norm, when in fact it is the majority. And so that disconnect is what I see as the problem. Whether you call it femtech or not, I don't have, you know, a big opinion on it.
Yeah. And we were also saying that we're four women here on stage, which does probably tell a lot, right? I mean, love the Slush team who organized the program, but no guys were invited on stage. What do you think?
that's what I also said to you, is that it's disturbing to me that we also are four women on stage, seeing us as responsible for discussing something that has to do with health tech in general, and we happen to have a female audience, which again makes up half of the world's population, so it should be equally as interesting a business case as anything else. But I would have loved to participate in this panel with a more diverse group and also more perspectives, because it's not a female issue. It's an investment issue, and it's a human issue, I'd say.
Yeah. And then you said, I mean, for me, it's interesting to hear when you talk about fundraising and how you brought the product to market. How has it changed the communications if you don't talk about femtech specifically? Mm-hmm. Or how has it just changed your behavior when speaking to investors, educating users, or educating just any third party or stakeholders?
I mean, I'd prefer to say we haven't changed anything, but we had to. And it's not so much towards the end consumer. That's very straightforward. We're working with women's health and reproductive health. But when fundraising, we've been very mindful of the narrative and how we come across, especially since we are two female founders working in emerging markets for us, and also having then 100% female audience. There's already impact written all over us, and we often get put in that space. But why aren't you? Are you an NGO? And you'd be surprised how often I get asked if we're an NGO just because we work with those wow. types of markets.
Yeah.
So we were conscious. I wouldn't say we changed, but we were very aware of not using the term impact and very consciously focusing on the commercial potential of what we want to build and the scale at which we want to build, because that seems to be the fear for most entrepreneurs, I'd say. Obviously, we're not special because we're women, but you have more to prove to get half the way.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'd say it's being very aware of what not to say.
I mean, from an investor, I also often get introduced to female founders because of exactly that reason. I'm pretty sure both of you have been in situations like that where, you know, it's like they're really struggling with fundraising. Men seem to not really understand, especially the male partners at venture capital firms, how big the market actually is, why there is a need for the product, because it's targeted to more of a female audience. And we usually like to think, you know, venture capital is all about the big ideas, but they do is still like a massive funding gap. So what do you think, I mean, especially from an investor perspective, now having seen, and you also having invested in a lot of female healthcare companies, what do you think we need to change or overcome to get more comfortable with the category, or yeah, help it become a bit more mainstream and accepted? And then I think there's a whole other topic around like the gender data gap or so that is out there. I mean, some of the devices we're using, or well, most of them, are not even designed, you know, for the female user in mind, including, you know, some of these nice wearables we're always wearing. Yeah, would love to hear, Dipali, from you, how you think about that.
Thank you for having me. Really excited to be here. Really talking about something that I love and I've invested in over the last few years, a few femtech companies. You know, like you said, I think firstly we need more female investors. Not to say that it's a female-only problem, but we definitely want more women in decision-making roles, because women just tend to empathize more and understand the problem. Having said that, 95% of the VC industry is male. So you need that man in the room to try and understand the problem. I remember I sat at a breakfast with a very prominent UK angel investor, and he told me all about his deals and how he's investing in super interesting sectors. And I said, do you invest in women's health? And he said, no, because I don't understand it. And I said, but did you grow up understanding crypto and blockchain and, you know, all the metaverse, for example? Yeah. You didn't. So you make an effort to understand. As an investor, you will never know enough as the founder. So you need to make an effort to understand what the founder is building, and men just need to make the effort. Beyond that, you know, I am always advocating in the UK ecosystem for more grant funding, because health and women's health is a long-term game. And especially in women's health, women are not just building product, but they're building the data and the science behind it, because we're so far behind. So it is just a longer game. So you need more patient capital, you need more grant funding. And lastly, I also think that the more exits we have, I don't want to say this, but it's proving out business models. The more we have like modern fertility or OVA health, you know, exiting, or the more we have Series C's and Series D's and the Mavens of the world, we are going to, you know, the VC industry operates on FOMO. They don't want to miss out. So, you know, those are some of the, I mean, of course, the bigger question around gender data gap is huge. Mm. It's not just investor founder, it's policymakers, it's government, it's education. It's a lot that has to come together to make it all work.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I was pleased to see some kind of like, yeah, menstrual cycle tracking now in Aura, for example. Great to have it 5 years later.
And the iPhone.
Yeah.
And we still don't have, like my daughter, 15-year-old, says, we don't have dresses with pockets, mommy. I have nowhere to put my phone.
Yeah. I know you have some thoughts about that as well. How do you think about the topic in general now, having seen and invested a lot of companies, and then also what has changed maybe since you started investing?
Since I started investing, or since we started to look at femtech at Maki, I think it's become obvious over the just past couple of years that it's becoming, in my view, actually a very hot space. Everyone wants to, whether it's a big fund, a small fund, a generalistic fund, or a specialist fund, everyone wants to do a femtech deal. So in that sense, there's definitely progress, but it's true that we need to get more male
involved. You say everyone wants to do femtech deals. I feel like I have the maybe different perception. Our partnership is a 50% female, which makes it a lot easier, I think. How has that been internally? Have your partners really specifically looked into the category with you as well, or?
Yeah, definitely. It's a whole team effort.
Awesome.
I would say.
Yeah.
And it obviously takes a team to come to an investment decision in the sense. So for sure, it's the whole team. And I don't think I've heard many of the teams that they have these debates as to whether it's niche or not, etc. But I don't think we've ever actually had that discussion internally.
Because amazing.
It's obviously it's not niche.
Yeah. Yeah. Tell me about some of the companies you've recently invested in, or one more recently.
The most recent investment was into a UK company called Chenis. So basically what they do, they have this mobile app for everyday women to sync their training with their cycle. So really kind of trying to help women hack their hormones and feel more balanced throughout their cycle. So starting from syncing their training, and obviously there's potential to expand into syncing your nutrition or syncing your sleep, etc., for just overall better well-being throughout the cycle, basically.
Yeah.
So that's the most recent. But then in terms of otherwise how we look at femtech, I would say we look at health in general, and femtech just happens to be one category within that we look at. And so very broadly everything from, I don't know, menopause to sex tech to reproductive health and fertility, and then some other areas longevity or hormonal health, etc., that we spend a little bit more time.
Longevity, everyone's very excited about that one. How have you evaluated the companies, or any commonalities you've seen in terms of difficulties of go-to-market from a regulatory perspective, which I think sometimes is a lot harder in Europe for the businesses than in the US? Or what is your perception there and criteria you're looking into?
So maybe if I don't go to regulation yet, but in terms of overall what we look at, so we definitely obviously love entrepreneurs who really deeply kind of understand the needs of their target audience. We want to see either a real kind of technological innovation and or some early signs of that you're able to build this kind of authentic community and a brand around your product. And we definitely love data and love entrepreneurs who understand the value of data. So I think it's pretty obvious that there's kind of related to this health or gender gap or data gap that you mentioned. I think it's pretty obvious that there's a massive big data opportunity within femtech. And basically, if companies are able to create these feedback loops from symptoms to how the treatments actually work, that's super valuable in the eyes of pharma, for instance, and that's we want to see that in the companies that we invest. So not necessarily only companies that kind of enable easier or quicker access to existing care, but rather companies who help in validating and creating new treatments and actually fundamentally improve the treatment outcomes.
Yeah, fantastic. So you're hunting more B2B or consumer propositions currently?
So that also, I would say, depends on the subcategory that we're talking about. I think in general, I don't know if you agree, but I think in general, many femtech companies have struggled to monetize their consumer proposition a little bit. And I'm seeing more and more companies turn into B2B and employee perks. Mm-hmm. I think that's going to be also crowded at some point, but I think that can be a smart way to kind of get to that first revenue, that first traction. But that being said, it doesn't change the fact that you have to build a product that fundamentally is great. I mean, even on the B2B side, it's not some magic pill that you can take and in case your consumer proposition doesn't work, and that then will solve everything for you. I mean, the B2B contracts will be up for renewal also at some point.
Yep.
So the end user, the employees, needs to still love the product and get real value out of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Love to hear actually your learnings from monetization or going to market there, figuring out different business models, obviously pricing, all these things. Super interesting topic. How are you kind of navigating the kind of have you navigated the market there?
Yeah, no, but one of the most important topics for us as a any founder-led company or any startup is to understand how you're going to make this into a scalable business, right? Mm-hmm. But our big challenge is that if you look at, for example, employee setups or B2B setups, we work in emerging markets or the next billion users, meaning that companies don't have the same perk systems. It doesn't get, you can't just apply the way you monetize to bigger corps because they don't work in nearly the same way. So for us, it's been making, you know, conscious bets. And for us, understanding the end consumer is going to be the most important thing, because if we build something that she wants and she needs, then we can leverage the payer user relationship and find both payers within the audience, but also other companies or insurance companies or data handlers that are interested. But so we're, you know, dedicated to the end consumer. So for us, also with regards to the high corruption, low trust in some of our markets, establishing a really strong brand has been key and instrumental to even start experimenting in monetization. Yep. So that's something we're doing this upcoming year, is to look at the B2C side, and then B2B coming up after that. But it's always a trade-off, and you know, with the fundraising, we often get that comment. I love what you do. I love you as a founder. I wish you had just started monetizing a bit. It becomes the universal. Sorry, I'm clumping all of you together, but it becomes a universal answer for why you don't want to invest, and that's fine. But it's hard to sometimes know, should we actually try and monetize already? Because I'm not sure, and that would be the right thing, and especially not in our markets with the audience we have. So we've opted out of optimizing for it for now and going to experiment much more in this upcoming year.
I mean, we're seeing a lot of community-first businesses in general in the industry. They're building a strong brand, almost just have a community that is the product initially, and then they're launching more, different pricing options. I think that model is still a little bit unproven at scale, and we've seen very few companies being incredibly successful or being successful in doing so. I know, Dipali, we talked about that whole community topic, and you're big on the community side as well, and with Alma Angels. What do you think about, in general, like community-first companies and helping also to educate the market a little bit more and building the brand around businesses?
Super interesting, because Therese, when I first met her, she also had a Facebook community, I remember, and she was migrating to an app. But, you know, just fun.
We'll have.
Thinking a little bit about how communities work. You run a community, I run a community. She ran a community. Communities tend to be different than networks, right? Communities tend to have slightly more unstructured communication than a network, so like a Facebook or a TikTok. And what ends up happening is the engagement tends to be lower than in a network. And now you're trying to build a product around this engagement. You're trying to get early adopters to adopt, you know, from the community this product, and then you're trying to then scale this product outside the community. So the product has to be phenomenal, and you're trying to scale it in markets, especially in the UK, where people are not used to paying for healthcare, right? The CAC is higher, the willingness to pay is low, and therefore monetization is a long game. You can't just see, you know, over a short period of time, can we monetize this community? Because it is really hard to do, which is why you're seeing companies like Peppy, which started B2C and now going B2B, because, you know, it's somewhat, even though sales cycles are long, it is an easier way to monetize the community. And I've been thinking about this, you know, other business models that have managed to monetize community have really been product first, because how do you build a venture scale business? You look at Minecraft, you know, my son started playing at 4, he's still playing it at 12. It's a community of game players, but it was product first, right? And so was GitHub, or more recently you can see the DAOs, you know, that are building communities and monetizing using a subscription, but very early days. And the question is, can you monetize these communities at scale and build a venture scale business? And I don't know yet. I don't know the answer to that question.
Yeah, that's a big question, right? So I think we had one unicorn this year in the women's health space, Maven Clinic, but otherwise, I think especially in Europe, it's a lot harder. In the US maybe, but still the community model has not been proven really yet. And it's a great way for early engagement, but it's still a tougher playground. How, I mean, it seems like the tone has shifted a lot in the investment community for femtech. I know you don't like me just using the word anymore. But what are the areas from an investment perspective that you feel like there's still a lot of gaps that need to be addressed? I personally have looked a lot into fertility. It's a topic I'm really excited about. Longevity, I just don't see a lot of companies. Would really love to hear your perspective and what you're seeing. You might be seeing very different companies than me as well. And what are the areas that feel like you haven't seen a lot of, like, yeah, exciting companies yet, but they're massive opportunities?
I mean, I've seen a lot more recently, super interesting ones in the US and things like abortion care and, of course, PCOS, endo. You know, these are diseases that take really long to diagnose. So the diagnosis side of it is super interesting.
Yeah.
But again, they're doing the clinical research that hasn't been done before. Mm-hmm. So it's a few years before the product.
Much jargon, by the way. Endo, you know, maybe half the people in the room don't even know what it means.
Endometriosis, sorry. And then I've seen, obviously, in maternal, you know, post-maternal,
yeah.
You know, there are certain underrepresented communities, people of color, where, you know, infant mortality rates are really high. So I've seen some in that sector. But I think women's health, to be honest, there's still a lot to be done in menopause or fertility. More recently, I saw fertility finance, which is a pain point. So, you know, somewhere between fintech and fertility, which I also thought was super interesting. So still seeing a lot of interesting things come out in this sector.
Yep.
And of course, teenage health, and I've seen some verticalization.
Teenage health?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So, and I've seen some in, you know, LGBTQ plus community in terms of sexual health. I personally have invested in 6 or 7 femtech companies from, you know, fertility, menopause, vaginal microbiome, sexual wellness, female hygiene product, incontinence. So I've seen a lot, but still seeing a lot of innovation come out.
Mm. And that's the thing, really, because, like, if you think about it, like, even in the, like, perfectly healthy Western woman's life cycle, there are, like, you know, from the moment that you get your period to, you know, you starting to educate yourself about sex, maybe giving birth, recovering from birth, menopause, etc. Like, even the, like, healthy journey, like, there are so many points where you can build better products for women, but then, like, thinking about all the other conditions that you might experience, like PCOS, etc., like, so many solutions are needed, and so little has been actually done in the past decades that I also just have to echo what you're saying, that there is still, like, there are just tons of opportunities ahead.
Yeah.
Obviously, it's a good question as to, like, I'm obviously then now seeing, like, for instance, like, different products with different hooks, like, I don't know, the PCOS being the hook, but then wanting to expand into something bigger going forward. So lots of companies popping up at pre-seed and seed. And I think the good question is then that, like, when will this kind of different hook products kind of converge, and kind of, like, what will be the, when will we start to see more femtech aggregators, and kind of, like, what will eventually become big enough, kind of? Which is, I guess, part of your question as to, like, what scales, and can this become big enough? Yep.
No, exactly, because one of the things I'm asking myself is there are different companies for different cycles, or, you know, depending on your age group as well. Mm. So you might not even think about it now, you might not even aware about a challenge that you as a woman, you're actually going to be facing at some point later in 5-10 years. So you're not even looking for solutions from a consumer mind, right? So that's also the phase I'm going through as an investor, right? I might not think about menopause now, but then, you know, it's super relevant for so many people. But then it's also usually a very kind of, like, a smaller age group that it's actually relevant for, which makes marketing, you know, a little bit harder sometimes, or at least the addressable market for the companies, because especially fertility, for example, or really specific products just targeted for helping you once you already have tried to get pregnant, actually, and you have to go through IVF. This is only relevant, like, literally between the age of like maybe 35 and 40, right?
Mm. The lifetime value isn't long enough. But having said that, if the price is, yeah, the margin is there, you can still...
Exactly. And it's a really high premium product. Yeah. Actually, the consumer has a super high willingness to pay because they're so desperate at some point, right? But it's going to be hard to keep growing with that user as well unless you really actually extend your product range. So I think that's the heart of it, right? Versus like with other companies or maybe non-super specific health companies, it might be easier to then continue with that customer.
But I think it will eventually be a combination of many things. So for instance, when it comes to this menopause thing, so first of all, like you're right that like you probably, even as a, like you're younger, but even like later on, you probably as a woman, you don't necessarily realize that some of the symptoms that you're having are in any way related to menopause at the kind of very beginning of the, or at the perimenopause phase. And so I think it comes down a lot to like in all other categories too, it comes down to us having more research and kind of like the average woman being, or women being more educated about the topics. And that's why we are also here talking about femtech. And I feel that the term is still needed, that women overall needs to be more educated so that they actually demand better products. And I think that will then kind of like help, for instance, when it comes to menopause. I think that's an example of where just in the past years, it's becoming more and more, or kind of less stigmatized as an area. It's becoming something that you would discuss with your friends. It's something that's part of the coffee table chats, kind of, and it's getting easier then in terms of customer acquisition too for these companies, because there will be these kind of super users who use your product, tell everyone about the amazing menopause journey that they're having with your product, and kind of that will then enable these companies to build a brand in a more efficient way than it has been possible just a couple of years back. So kind of like there are these different building blocks that you need for these companies to actually get forward.
Completely agree. I think we do need the term initially to actually educate the audience more, and then at some point probably it's started more as a movement. It's going to be a lot more mainstream, but I know you have some different thoughts here.
Necessarily different. Yeah. I would just want to clarify. For me, it can feel like we're doing something. When we put the name on it and everyone talks about femtech, it feels like we're doing something. We feel active. We feel good about ourselves. It feels like, yeah, we're on it. We're up to speed. But for me, I see the product coming out from male and female entrepreneurs for addressing topics relating to women's health and male health that are great. It's not in the product development, it's in the funding, because you don't see enough of these initiatives getting enough of funding, then they can't grow, then you also can't build more women entrepreneurs who make exits and earn a lot of money because they don't get the funding, and the businesses don't get the same potential to scale and prove their potential also. So you have, it's the funding gap that I get stuck on, and that's why I don't really care about the term so much. It doesn't do anything for the change. It just manifests a title that can make investment companies feel like they're onto something, when in fact they might, if you show me that you actually put more funds towards products and services and companies that solve these globally huge issues, great, then I don't care about the term. But as long as nothing moves, I mean, I'm not opposed to it, I just don't see that's not where the discussion should lie. It should lie in why don't more of these companies with clear monetary value, like Peanut, Maven, Flow, who like raised a huge amount of money, they're proving that they can monetize. And even if not now, then further down, why don't more actually get excited about the bottom line? Because it's the monetary aspect that VCs want, sure, right?
Yep. Yeah, so you're clearly against us using...
No, that's not what I am. I'm not against it. I think other things.
So I'm also like, I'm indifferent between, like, I don't care about the term femtech, especially if it has some negative connotations to it. Like, we can come up with a new term, but I do think that, like, women's health is an area that should be worked on, should be talked about, should be... there should be
elevated,
more research.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Until at that point when we actually kind of bridge that gap.
Yep.
I agree. I think it's less about the term, as long as it drives capital into the sector.
Yes.
I will
That's
say
the whole
that
point.
There is a lot of unconscious biases out there. You know, I am biased. I only invest in women, and I'm sure I have biases because I probably compare an all-female team that I met today to a fantastic all-female team that I met yesterday. So that's an unconscious bias that I clearly need to work on because they're two separate businesses, right? So I think the funding has more to do with the biases and how do we overcome them and how do we work on them. But having said that, we wouldn't be here even on stage bonding if it wasn't just for the term femtech. So even if it just brings us together, building businesses, innovating, talking about it, and hey, if we didn't talk about the vote, we wouldn't have the vote. So sometimes it's just good to talk about these things to get them out in the open.
Yeah. Fantastic ending. Thank you so much, Therese, Dipali, and Polina. We're out of time, and thank you all for tuning in.
Thank you.
Thank you.